والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، وبعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، أعاذنا الله وإياكم من النار. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة، ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة، وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيًا عن قومه ورسولًا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته، وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. Unfortunately, the system is not responding, so I'll just ad-lib as we do it. Last time, we finished part of the story of the children of Israel, and we stopped at the section where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had saved them from Fir'aun and his people. And as he does, they crossed the Red Sea, and Pharaoh and his people were drowned. And that was the promise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Moses, that you ask me and I will help you get over this, and I will take care of you and your people. So what happens after is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited Moses for an appointment. وَإِذْ وَعَدْنَا مُوسَى أَرْبَعِينَ لَيْلَةً ثُمَّ اتَّخَذْتُمُ الْعِجْلَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَأَنْتُمْ ظَالِمُونَ. And behold and remember, as we have made an appointment for Moses for 40 nights, and then you ended up taking the calf for worship. They took a calf that was made of gold for God. A grave sin and a grave violation of their commitment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine a whole community afraid of their enemy who is running after them to extinguish or exterminate all of them, and he got terminated, he and his community, his supporters, and they are all saved. Mind you, they were walking across the Red Sea, a distance of about 150 miles, about between 100 and 150 miles. Imagine the time it takes to cross that distance. So they came all the way down through the Gulf of Suez, and they came to the left or west branch, and then they crossed across the desert of Sinai, across Mount At-Tur. And it takes a lot of time to do this, especially if you are going walking. Imagine a whole community just coming to the sea, and Allah tells Moses, just hit the sea with your stick, and the sea parted on the sideways. فَانْفَلَقَ فَكَانَ كُلُّ فِرْقٍ كَالطَّوْدِ الْعَظِيمِ. Every side became like a whole huge mountain. Water. And they are to walk on the bed of the sea. Imagine the fear, looking behind them, seeing Pharaoh and his people running after them. They were walking, Pharaoh and his people were riding their horses and chariots and carts. So it's an inconceivable dissimilarity in an asymmetric war. And within that fear, they are still pulling the bags of wealth they had to carry, the bags of valuables they have, of gold or anything else, because they are heading to a place they don't know where they are heading. They don't know what they will face. So they carried everything and they pulled with them animals to carry that stuff and to use them for milk and food and other things. So they were going very slow, a huge community. With them were not only animals, of course they got their women and their children. And imagine a large community running on the bed of the sea, going to nowhere that they know. They have never crossed the sea before, and they've never seen the sea opening for them. And the Quran uses a word that is very telling. It says, فَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرِ, that we parted the sea by you. When they step in, the sea opens and the floor shows up and they start walking. In this environment, which might have taken days, maybe even weeks, God knows, with all of this crowd, and Pharaoh is pursuing and running after them, thinking that he can follow with immunity, that he will also will cross on the bed of the sea, and things that happened with Moses and his community ahead of them will also be available for them. He doesn't know what was being planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at the end, وَأَغْرَقْنَا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ, we drowned Pharaoh and his community, his supporters, وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ, and you were looking. You saw it happening with your own eyes. I want you to remember this, because in few ayat, they will get to be asking for something else to look at. Then what happens? They took the calf for God. What is the story of the calf? It's mentioned in details in both Surah Taha and in Surah Al-A'raf. A man by the name Musa the Samurite, and he told them, collect all of your gold, let us melt it. They melt the gold, and he made a calf-like shape. عجلاً جسداً له خوار. It makes some noise. And as it does make this noise, Musa the Samurite would tell them, this is your God and Musa's God. It's an amazing direction. Someone who invented a physical image of an animal from the gold he collected from the community, and he's telling them, this is your God and Musa's God. And would they believe him? It looks like they did. So, but not all of them. The Quran sorts the story for us, that the majority of them worshiped the calf, but some of them did not. Harun was with them, and Harun was assigned to take care of the community. وَقَالَ مُوسَى لِأَخِيهِ هَارُونَ اخْلُفْنِي فِي قَوْمِي, take charge of the community, take responsibility for the leadership of the community, and don't follow the path of the corrupt ones. وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ سَبِيلَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. So Harun started to talk to them, guys, what are you doing? You're worshiping a calf. You made it with your own hands. It's made out of gold. This could not be God. But they wouldn't listen. They wouldn't listen. So what happened is, Moses finished the 40 nights with Allah, and he comes back to find them worshiping the calf. He holds to Harun's beard, and it looks like it was long. And he pulls it, and he rebukes Harun. مَا مَنَعَكَ إِذْ رَأَيْتَهُمْ ضَلُّوا أَن تَتَّبِعَنِي أَفَعَصَيْتَ أَمْرِي, what stopped you from following my command? Why did you disobey my direction and my command to you? And Harun offered two excuses. In Surah Taha, he says, إني خشيت أن تقول فرقت بين بني إسرائيل ولم ترقب قولي. I was afraid to face up with them and you entrusted me to protect and keep them, not to create disturbance or fights or splits. So that what I understood your command to be. And in Surah Al-A'raf, he made another justification or reply. He said, يَبْنَ إِنَّ الْقَوْمَ اسْتَضْعَفُونِي وَكَادُوا يَقْتُلُونَنِي فَلَا تُشْمِدْ بِيَ الْأَعْدَاءِ. These people, they were about to kill me. So don't get them to glow in my own punishment. Don't let them glow. Don't give them joy in what you're doing to me. Okay? استضعفوني. They took advantage of my weakness. I was one among many. So if I initiated any fight, I could have been killed and the community would have been lost. So in Surah Al-Baqarah where we are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them, وَإِذْ وَعَدْنَا مُوسَى أَرْبَعِينَ لَيْلَةً ثُمَّ اتَّخَذْتُمُ الْعِجْلَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَأَنْتُمْ ظَالِمُونَ ثُمَّ عَفَوْنَا عَنْكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Imagine the worst sin anyone could commit against Allah, shirk. They commit the shirk and they challenge Allah by taking a calf, a handmade golden calf, as God, and they bear unto worshiping Him. And then Allah says, I forgive you, so that they may be grateful. What an opportunity. This is like giving somebody life after death. Somebody is on the verge of heading into hellfire, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, make a U-turn, come back. I will receive you. I will re-embrace you, but just you have to repent. What was the repentance requirements? The repentance requirements, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ إِنَّكُمْ ظَلَمْتُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ بِاتِّخَاذِكُمُ الْعِجْلِ فَتُوبُوا إِلَى بَارِئِكُمْ فَقُتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Their punishment was that Allah told them through Moses, of course, that you need to kill each other. But the Quran doesn't use the word kill each other. It says, فَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, because every human being is the same nafs as any other human being. فَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. The intention was that the ones who were obedient to Harun and committed to their covenant with Moses and Allah, they were supposed to kill those who went wrong, those who worshipped and made the calf, those who believed and spread the rumor that this is the God of Moses and your God, and you need to worship him until Moses comes back. So this is the punishment. Why is killing each other or killing themselves, as said in the ayah, a punishment? Because committing shirk is worse than killing each other. When you kill somebody, and I'm not making little of this action, but the Quran parallels the shirk with the killing. The Quran parallels spreading corruption and mischief as killing. Okay? The Quran, in fact, says that الفتنةُ أشدُّ من القتل. What is fitna? Fitna is to subject someone to severe torment or oppression, to coerce them to change their faith. The Quran is saying this is worse than killing somebody. If somebody forces somebody to change their faith, they are killing their spirits. They are killing their soul. They are killing their heart. Why? Because they are attacking their conscience. They are attacking their conscience. And when your conscience is attacked and you are coerced, it is worse than killing the physical person. So the parallel is very clear in the Quran. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. If you kill one soul, it's like killing the whole humanity. If you spare or save one soul, it is like saving the entire humanity. So Allah tells them, go back, repent to Allah, and your repentance is for the good ones, the righteous ones, to kill the evil ones. And once they started to engage, and what is said in the history is, they have killed about 70,000 people. That's a huge number. And that tells you that that was a huge community by the numbers of their time. So after doing this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the repentance and told them, stop the killing, let us spare the lives of those who are not killed yet, and let us see that they are given a chance to repent. فَتَابَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Then Allah accepted their repentance. إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He is the one who accepts repentance. He is the merciful one. What happens next is they come back to Moses. After all of this forgiveness and repentance and going back to sin and repentance and forgiveness, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that they went to Moses, and what they said was, لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ حَتَّى نَرَى اللَّهَ جَهْرَ. See, they saw Pharaoh being in his last moment of demise just behind them when they were watching from the front of the fleeing community. They saw it with their own eyes. Now they want to see Allah eye to eye, plainly, manifestly. Let Allah come and we want to see Him eye to eye. حَتَّى نَرَى اللَّهَ جَهْرَةً. جَهْرَةً means, as you would say, in the daylight, manifestly and physically. So they neither accept that Allah is unlike His creation. Allah is not a body. Allah is unlike His creation. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like unto Allah. لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٌ. Nobody is equal to Allah. Nobody is like Allah. But they challenge Musa, we will not believe you until you show us Allah eye to eye. What happens? فَأَخَذَتْكُمُ الصَّاعِقَةُ again. وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. You want to see Allah? No, what you will see is the thunderbolt coming to take you out. And look what happened after. They are exposed to all of this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after they are all put to death, فَأَخَذَتْكُمُ الصَّاعِقَةُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِكُمْ. What else a miracle could be other than putting an entire community to death and then giving them life again? What else is a stronger ayah, evidence, miracle to show them so that they are humbled before Allah? But no, nothing that Allah showed them or gave them of blessings or miracles or evidence would change their attitude. The ayat in this section, ayat between 50 or 49 until 60, they talk clearly about an attitude that is entrenched. When they are blessed, they are disobedient. When they are punished, they say, Musa, ud'u lana rabbaka bima ahid indak. La'in kashafta anna ad-durr. If you take away the punishment, we will go back and we'll be fine. And when Allah takes away and lifts the punishments and the torment they are subjected to, they go back. It's an amazing attitude. It reflects the same attitude with many people, not only the children of Israel. There are many people who, when they are blessed, they are disobedient. And I want you to think about it. Why is it that some people, when they are blessed, they turn into disobedience? It is because it's a phenomenal issue that we need to look at. It is because when a person is blessed, he is either focusing on the gifts or the giver. If he focuses on the gifts, they distract him from the giver. So they end up becoming disobedient and ungrateful. But if the person focuses on the giver, it would trigger thankfulness and gratitude. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ عَفَوْنَا عَنْكُمْ ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. We have done this, revived you, so that you may offer gratitude. But when they are happy to be revived, more than they are happy that who revived them is Allah, they do not offer gratitude, they offer resentment. Why? Because they keep asking the wrong questions and building the false logic. Why did you do this to us? Why did you do this to us? So instead of offering gratitude for the blessings and the relief that Allah gives us, we start questioning His wisdom. Why did you choose me to do this to me? Instead of saying, Alhamdulillah, for the relief or the blessing He gives me. So that is one of the lessons that we learn from that story. Someone was asking me as to why are we talking about the children of Israel? Why do we talk about their story? Well, we're talking about the Quran, and we're talking about human attitudes. We're talking about community attitudes that Allah is displaying for us to learn lessons so that we don't fall in the same pitfalls. That's the point. The point is not to regurgitate what they are doing or what they have done or to point finger at others. The point is to look in the mirror. Are we doing the same? Are we acting in the same way? And instead of asking Allah, why are Muslims not doing well? Why are Muslims the downtrodden, the victims, the prey for all nations today? Well, look at our attitude first. And this is the moral of the story of the children of Israel, or one of the lessons that we need to learn from the life story of the children of Israel. So as we go forward, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what he did. وَإِذْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى what? الْكِتَابَ وَالْفُرْقَانِ. The Quran is called Furqan. The Injil is called Furqan. The Torah is called Furqan. Why? Because it's one message, but different laws. But the common thread is, it is the tool with which you could distinguish between right and wrong. They are all guidance, right? But the Quran exceeds what the role of the Bible or the Torah was, because the Quran is muhaiminan alayh. The Quran is a judge over the book that we call the people of the book in reference to that book, which is the Bible in totality of the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Quran is the final criteria by which you know what is right in that book and what is wrong in that book and where is the correction. So Allah is telling us that we have given Moses this criteria and this book, the Torah, so that they are guided. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. And this is when Moses told them what is in the book, and Allah at that time sent to him the punishment for worshiping the calf and how they are going to get the repentance and forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what happened is they were taken out by the thunderbolt. Thunderbolts are series of lightnings that can take an entire community out. They come in series, not just one thunderstorm or one lightning strike. It is in a continuum. So it took them out, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrected them so that they may be grateful, which they didn't. And what happened after is Allah, after he repented, they repented and accepted the repentance, Allah tells them, enter into this village, this town, which was and is Jerusalem, the Holy Land. But they saw that people over there are too strong for them. So they said, no, we're not getting in. The story is mentioned in Surah Al-Ma'idah. But the summary of it is, Allah told them, enter into this village and pray to Allah and submit to Allah. As you enter in the state of prostration. وَقُولُوا حِطَّةٌ. Ask Allah to take out your sins. حِطَّةٌ means حُطَّ عَنَّا خَطَايَانَا. Forgive for us our sins and clear our record. وَظَلَّلْنَا عَلَيْكُمُ الْغَمَامِ. We shaded you with the clouds. And we've sent down unto you manna and salwa, the quails, and a drink like honey to give them energy and all of that they need in the desert of Sinai during their diaspora. Because they refused to enter the holy city, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, go wherever you want, and they were barred from the city for 40 years. And there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the desert, he gives them all what they need and the best of what he has of provision. Ready to eat meals that are prepared and they are sent down from heaven. أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَنَّ وَالسَّلْوَى. Ready to drink honey-like drink. And السَّلْوَى is quails, which are small birds, easy to eat, easy to digest, and they are very light for the stomach. So when you are in the heat of the desert, clouds are covering you, you are in the shade, and this is an amazing miracle that wherever they go, the clouds are following them. So this is a continuous miracle that they would live in for 40 years. This is not one day stuff. This is not an incident. This is history of miracles that they have lived in. But nevertheless, وَمَا ظَلَمُونَ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. They did not wrong us, Allah saying. They wronged themselves. Their disobedience is their punishment. Their disobedience is their wrongdoing. And they will bear the consequences. And when Allah told them, say, حِطَّة, which means take away our sins, wipe clear our sins, instead they said, حِنْطَة, which is wheat, right? And that switch or twist of the words has been recorded as a habit for this community. They used to twist and change the words of Allah, either to make mockery of Moses and the revelation, or to make mockery of how Moses would ask them to do or say certain things in certain ways. So Allah says, فَبَدَّلَ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا قَوْلًا غَيْرَ الَّذِي قِيلَ لَهُمْ فَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا رِجْزًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Here, the ayah, or that section of the ayah, is focusing on the wrongdoers. So the punishment is not to overwhelm the entire community, because they have righteous people too. So Allah is saying only the wrongdoers, either those who initiate the sinfulness or those who are inviting others to do sins and be like them, or those who are persistently sinning despite the guidance and despite the forgiveness that Allah has showered them with. So I think we'll stop here today and we'll continue inshallah next week. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the lessons from their life and to make our community a real better community, and to give us the determination, the commitment, and the discipline to follow His command. Allahumma ameen. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد, the final ayah, two ayahs in this section is ayah 60. And as they were in the diaspora, of course it's very hot, and they ask Musa, we need water. We eat the salwa, the quails, and it's cooked and nice. We drink honey-like liquid, it's very nice, but this makes us thirsty. We need water. وَإِذِ اسْتَسْقَى مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ. So Moses asked Allah to send down water for his people. And Allah says, we will do it, but we will do it in a miracle. Because if it came from heaven just like this, it's rain, right? And rain always comes from heaven, so there is nothing new. So Allah tells Moses, hit the rock with your stick. And what happens? 12 springs gush out. You know that they are 12 tribes of the children of Israel. So He doesn't only give them water, but He gives them 12 springs of water so that they don't fight. So every tribe will have their own spring, right? So this is not just one miracle, it is multitudes of miracles in one miracle. وَإِذِ اسْتَسْقَى مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ فَقُلْ نَضْرِبْ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرَ فَانْفَجَرَتْ مِنْهُ 12 عَيْنًا قَدْ عَلِمَ كُلُّ أُنَاسٍ مَشْرَبَهُمْ كُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ اللَّهِ وَلَا تَعْثَوْا فِي الْأَرْضِ مُفْسِدِينَ. Eat and drink from the provision of Allah that He has showered you with. And each community has known where their own spring is. So this is 12 tribes, they get 12 springs. So that they go together as one tribe and they drink as much as they want. So when those springs started to gush, they are amazed. But after they drink, what happened? They go ahead again and go back to their old habits. And Allah tells them, eat and drink, and do not roam the earth spreading mischief and corruption in the land. Don't be mufsideen. وَلَا تَعْثَوْا فِي الْأَرْضِ مُفْسِدِينَ. So this is what happens with the children of Israel. And the question we really need to ask, it doesn't have to be the same. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Muslim Ummah recently, right? How many springs of oil and gas, right? How much did Allah bless our Ummah? Are we grateful, or are we loyal even to Allah? Are we loyal to our own ummah, or are we using the gifts Allah gave us to bless others, right? And to buy our own wrong perceived security for the elites of the ummah and forget about the rest of the ummah. So the elites surface and the rest will drown despite the blessings Allah has given our ummah. The entire world would love to have the blessings Allah has given us. And this is part of why there is a war and why all the current wars are around the oil fields. Why all the wars are around the oil fields. The Operation Iraqi Freedom, as was labeled at the time of George W. Bush, was originally named Operation Iraqi Liberty. The acronym is OIL. But then somebody advised George W. Bush, this is too obvious. Let us call it Operation Iraqi Freedom. Let us make a decoy name that nobody will catch what it actually means. So Allah is telling us where we should be, and He is giving us more than what we need, and He is pushing us to cooperate on matters of goodness and never cooperate on matters of aggression. But we end up violating every time, like the community that Allah has warned us against, the community of the children of Israel. And after all of these blessings, here they go again to Moses. وَإِذْ قُلْتُمْ يَا مُوسَى لَنْ نَصْبِرَ عَلَىٰ طَعَامٍ وَاحِدٍ فَادْعُ لَنَا رَبَّكَ يُخْرِجْ لَنَا مِمَّا تُنْبِتُ الْأَرْضِ مِنْ بَقْلِهَا وَقِثَّائِهَا وَعَدَسِهَا وَبَصَلِهَا. All of the, you know, very, very delicious appetizers, right? We are fed up with honey and quails. This diet is old fashioned now. We are fed up, we are bored. Give us something different. So he says, get down. And they get down back to where? They get down back to Pharaoh, and they are tortured and tormented and oppressed because of their disobedience. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the same ayah, ayah number 61, that وَضُرِبَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الذِّلَّةُ وَالْمَسْكَنَةُ. They were covered and seized and sieged by humiliation and exploitation and harmful things. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ. They used to deny and violate the ayat of Allah, and they used to also kill prophets. This is not a small violation. وَيَقْتُلُونَ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ أَوْ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ ذَلِكَ بِمَا عَصَوْا وَكَانُوا يَعْتَدُونَ. So whatever punishment that Allah instituted against them, it is because of their disobedience. The question is, are we more obedient to Allah than they were? Are we not playing games with Allah? Are we not going back and forth? We want this, and Allah gives us what we ask for, and then we violate our commitment to Allah. This is the moral of the story that we need to learn from. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the knowledge and the power to commit, and the respect for His ayat, and the discipline to practice our faith. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa'afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt. وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم قنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. اللهم اختم لنا مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. وأقم الصلاة.